2. 1, 2. 1, 2. Yeah? Okay, good. Good morning, all. We wish to start our proceeding. We want to thank everyone for coming out to support the Mc Kenzie family. Of course, all of you may be either family, relative, or friend of Mr. Larry Mc Kenzie. So we wish to thank you very much for that, and we now open with a song, and then we'll follow it with a prayer and introduce our speaker for today. Our opening song is on your program, and it's entitled, "He Will Make You Strong." So we can now have that.
There was a reason why God brought the truth
to you
and called you from the darkness to the light. Within your heart, He saw the longing that you had to search for Him and practice what is right. You promised Him in prayer to do His will. He helped you then, and He will help you still. With Jesus' blood, He bought you. To God you now belong. So He will make you firm, and He will make you strong. He'll guide you and protect you as He has all along. Yes, He will. Jesus' blood, He bought you to guide you.
let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Jehovah by name, we thank you for the mercies that you have extended to humankind. We thank you that despite the sin of Adam and the ensuing pain, suffering, and death that we will all experience in this life, that you have given us the opportunity to learn about you, to learn about your sovereignty and your name and what it means. You are the God of purpose, a God who will never fail to fulfill his purpose. So we thank you that your purpose for Adam and Eve, though they failed, hasn't failed in our behalf. There's still the opportunity for us. And we thank you for sending your Son, Christ Jesus, in order to make that possible. And we long for the day when we will be able to resume our true sonship and daughterhood with you as true children of God. We beg for your mercies, though at this time, because of our imperfections, our shortcomings, our failings, and our stubbornness sometimes, to learn about you and to practice what is right. So may your spirit be with the speaker, may your spirit be with all who endeavor to learn and carry out your will. And please help us, because we live in Satan's world, we live in a difficult time, we live in a time when humans struggle with one another just to make an ends meet. So we thank you for this day. We know it's a solemn day for those here, and we pray your support of them, we pray your comfort upon them, because as the scriptures say, you are the God of all comfort. May we benefit from the talk to be delivered, and may your spirit continue to be with us as we seek to apply your word in our life. We ask you these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to now introduce our brother who would address us, Michael Garcia.
Well, we all have our programs with us, and we recognize that Larry had made his three squanten. But he leaves behind Marilyn, Brian, Gerald, Nathalie, who is deceased, Sean, Warren, Christopher, and Shelly-Ann. Patricia, Bernice, Helen, Carlton, Closestus, and Ethan, Acklin, I hope I have it right, Abelise, Kareem, Fitmer, Amina, Victoria, and Nicholas. So we know that this is indeed a difficult moment for all of us. Death is something that we will not come to terms with. We will not come to terms with it. It leaves in us a vacuum when a good friend, a family member dies. It's as though a hole is left in us. And we continue to feel this grief over time. But I want to assure you that this is normal. This is not an indication that you lack faith or you don't have hope. It's a normal reaction, and I want to encourage you, let it happen. If you feel like letting it happen, just let it happen, because if you withhold it, you might find yourself in some challenges. It's a time of deep grief, as we said, because death was never part of God's purpose. It was never part of God's purpose. When he created Adam and Eve, they were to live on this earth. He gave this earth as their home, and they were to take care of the earth, take care of the animals, and continue to care for the earth, produce children, of course. But we know what happened. Eve listened to the enemy. She partook of a fruit that Jehovah said not to eat from. Jehovah wasn't starving anybody. He told them, eat to satisfaction from every tree in the garden, except the tree that's in the middle of the garden. And he told them why. The day you eat from it, you will positively die. So had they obeyed, this would never happen. But we know that Adam followed suit and he ate as well. And when they had children, all of the children, including us, we have been affected by what they chose to do. So we have no control over what's happening to us. We have to learn to deal with it. But I'll tell you this, it is not going to last forever. Men of faith, Abraham cried when his wife Sarah died. Jesus Christ, when he went to resurrect Lazarus, even though he was going there to resurrect Lazarus, he wept. So there's nothing wrong with how you feel this morning. But the Bible tells us of a hope. And it is very important for us to understand the hope that Jehovah holds out to us. I'll tell you something about Jehovah. In Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11, Pastor, I could read that for you. Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11, listen to what the scripture says. And just reflect on it for a little bit. 55, 10 and 11 tells us, not a single promise out of all the promises that Jehovah has made. Let me make sure that I read it good. It says, for just as the rain and the snow pour down from heaven and do not return there until it saturate the earth, making produce and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Listen to this verse. So my word that goes out from my mouth will be. It will not return to me without results, but it will certainly accomplish whatever is my delight, and it will have sure success in what I sent it to do. Now, this is the Creator. He speaks to us. As we sit here this morning, I recognize that we all have confidence in that Creator. Because things are happening here while we are sitting here. We are actually moving, you know. We are not static. Because you know that the earth goes around the sun. And the earth is traveling at 66,600 miles per hour. I am not seeing anybody holding on, frightened, scared. We're comfortable. And that's because we have confidence in the Creator. So what can we look forward to when he says his word will have results? How did Jehovah feel about what happened? He was displeased, but immediately he put things in place. Most of us would know the scripture, John 3:16. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone exercising faith in him might not be destroyed, but have everlasting life. And that's his promise. We just read in Isaiah 55, 10 and 11, every word that he says will come to pass. We just have a waiting period. We have a period where we have to wait for things to take place. All of us have been affected by what Adam and Eve did. And in the book of Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, I want to share this text with you. Romans 5 and the 12th verse. Let me just get that quickly. It says, through one man, sin entered into the world, and death spread to all men because they had all sinned. Right? My fingers are sticking up, but that's the scripture. It spread to all men because we have all sinned. Jehovah has put things in place. John 3:16, we discussed that text already. And his son Jesus Christ had to come to the earth as a man, because a man disobeyed. It was Adam disobeyed. So he was in the heavens with his father, but he had to take the form of a man, come to the earth, and give his life as a ransom so that God's promise will be realized. Most of us here know about the ransom, because there was a time in this country when people were kidnapping our family members, and you had to pay a ransom price to get them back alive. And that's what's happening here. To remove this stain of sin, Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice for all of us sitting here. So that we have that hope, Jehovah's purpose is going to be fulfilled in the future. Think for a minute what that would have cost Jehovah. A sinless man, sinless individual, spirit creature in the heavens, coming to the earth to give up his life for us. Do we really appreciate what Jehovah has done? Does that indicate that he loves us? And if he did that, what about the other things that he says he will do? Will he not do them? Of course he would. We have that confidence that he would. So the book of Revelation 21, verse 4, even though we are experiencing what we are going through now, Revelation 21 and verse 4 gives us this promise. It says, "And he will wipe out every tear from their eyes, and death will be no more. Neither will mourning, nor outcry, nor pain be any more. The former things have passed away." The last book in the Bible, Revelation 21. Jehovah says, death will be no more. And that becomes possible because of Jesus' ransom sacrifice. Even Jesus Christ, when he came to the earth, at Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, he says, he came not to be ministered to, but to minister. So he wasn't a saga boy coming here looking for people to praise him. No. He was working. Not to be ministered to, but to minister and to give his life as a ransom in exchange. 1 Corinthians assures us, 1 Corinthians 15, 22, 23, that resurrection is going to take place. Now, Larry, I've known Larry for a pretty long time, at least 5 years, it could be more. And Larry understood what he read in God's Word, the Bible. Larry understood that so well that every year, at a certain time of the year, we would assemble at what we call the memorial of Jesus' death. Jesus himself said, "Keep doing this in remembrance of me." And Larry never missed one of those as long as he had the ability to attend. He never missed one. So now Larry knew the hope that he has. How should that affect us? Well, Larry made the effort to be there. He was able to put the scriptures together well. He knew why we're in this position, because of Adamic sin. He knew the ransom sacrifice was especially important for us to live according to God's purpose. And remember, God's purpose must take place. Whatever he says, there's no individual, no human, no spirit creature, nobody could stop his purpose. Larry knew that. Larry had that kind of confidence in Jehovah. And that's why he was always present at the memorial. Jesus Christ gave up his life so that God's purpose will be realized. Now, I want to invite you to open to John 5, and we're going to read these two verses, 28 and 29. John 5, 28 and 29. These are Jesus' words. I think I'm going to get it faster here. John 5, 28 and 29. These verses say, "Do not be amazed at this, for the hour is coming in which all those in the memorial tombs will hear his voice and come out. Those who did good things to a resurrection of life, and those who practiced vile things to a resurrection of judgment." These are Jesus' words. He says, don't marvel at this. There is going to be a resurrection. And this is what Larry understood. He had confidence in the resurrection. Now, who's going to be resurrected? It says the righteous and the unrighteous. Now that highlights a quality of our loving Father Jehovah. The righteous people are the ones who know. They know what Jehovah expects, and they do it, and they benefit. The unrighteous individuals don't know. They have probably never read this. So they don't know. They live life, and there are many families who live life without any kind of spiritual aspect to their life. They simply do not know. Those ones who did not know as well, according to the scriptures, will be resurrected. The wicked who know and choose not to do it, well, obviously, they are saying, I don't have anything to do with this ransom that you're talking about. I'm not interested in the ransom. And that is where Larry was different. He knew about the ransom. He came to the memorial, and he was making the changes in his life. Like all of us, we have changes that we have to make. Stripping off the old personality. Probably you would have seen the changes in Larry over time because of what he was learning. So the scriptures highlight to us that this is going to be reality. I want to read that text for you in Acts 24:15. I want to read it just as it is in the scripture. Acts 24:15. Verse 15 says, "I have hope toward God, which hope these men are all also look forward to, that there is going to be a resurrection of both the righteous and the unrighteous." So we explain what the right, who would be the righteous, who would be the unrighteous. Now there's a lovely text that I would like all of us to pay attention to. And it's the text of Romans chapter 6 and verse 7. I'm going to read it. I'm going to read it slowly. And I want us to think about what it says. Romans 6, we're looking at verse 7. It says, "For the one who has died has been acquitted from his sin." Did you get that, friends? The one who has died has been acquitted of his sins. So Larry is not going to be charged again for whatever he would have done wrong. He's acquitted of that. So what does that tell us? Larry's death wipes away all the errors that he had made, and we all do make errors. He is acquitted from his sins. So the question, we beg the question, how should this, our presence here this morning, affect us? We have heard a few scriptures. We understand what is God's purpose for us. And we know that everything that Jehovah says will come true. That sacrifice would have cost him a lot. But he did it out of love for all of us here. How should our presence here today, this morning, affect us? Do you feel, do you believe that God's purpose will be realized? Our ability to be here this morning was dependent on Jehovah. Every single thing that we do, we are dependent on Jehovah. You know, we like to think of ourselves as big men, and I could do this and I could do that. All of us are dependent on Jehovah. So the opportunity that we have to be here should stimulate in us. Should I reflect a little bit more about what Jehovah has done for me? Should I take a little more time to think about the sacrifice that Jesus did on our behalf? Should I get to know more about that? And if I have to make changes in my life, is it worth the effort to make those changes in my life? Well, I tell you, when we are obedient to God's laws, we benefit ourselves. We are happier individuals. We have a nice, clean conscience. We can smile. We can laugh. We are happy because we know we're doing our best to please our loving Creator, Jehovah. And that in itself can lengthen our lives. So we all want to make the effort to get to know Jehovah better and to understand his purpose. The resurrection hope provides an incentive to learn about him and to do his will. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58, the penultimate text that I'm going to use this morning, 1 Corinthians 15, 58, tells us this. says, "Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always having plenty to do in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain." So whatever we do, it's not like for working for the governments, working for our employers. This has purpose in connection with the Lord. So, Larry, I would say, he's in a better place than we are, you know. because we have to give an account. We have to give an account for our actions, how we use our lives in the future. Larry has been acquitted from his sins. We want to ensure, therefore, that we make the effort and show appreciation for what Jehovah and Jesus have done for us. In the times ahead, we want to keep in mind that this grief that the family experiences now is not going to be over in a flash. This is going to be with them for a while. So take up your telephone. Give them a little call. Marilyn, how are you doing this morning? How are you feeling, Gil? Let me share a text with you. Comfort, comfort the bereaved. You can carry something for them. In this kind of situation, you don't want to cook. You don't want to eat. It's a funny situation. So we can do whatever we can to give comfort to those who grieve. And my final text this morning is going to be from the 9th Psalm, verses 9 and 10. Before I read it, I would like to just, again, as the chairman said, express my sincere thanks on behalf of the Mackenzie family for being here to support. They will need our support for some time yet in the future. So let us keep that in mind. But our determination then will be, as the 9th Psalm says, Psalm 9, we're going to consider verses 9 and 10. And this is what it says. Jehovah will become a secure refuge for the oppressed, a secure refuge in times of distress. Those knowing your name will trust in you. You will never abandon those seeking you, O Jehovah. Let me just say that just a little slower. Jehovah will become a secure refuge for the oppressed, a secure refuge in times of distress. Those knowing your name will trust in you. Jehovah's promise will take place. We are going to be living right here on this earth, so that God's purpose that he gave to Adam and Eve to care for the earth and the animals and everything here, we are going to be doing that. And there will be nothing to stop us from completing that work, because there'd be no more sickness, no more death, no more sorrow, no more grief. God's purpose will have been accomplished. So to the family members, be positive. God's word can make us strong. It can give us the power to deal with the challenges that we face. Look at the situation in the world. It's a lot of grief for many people. But we can hold on to God's word and remember this lovely prayer that all of us know, that Our Father prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is God's will. So to all of family members, continue to rely on your loving Father, Jehovah. His purpose must be accomplished. So having said that, we want to bring closure to this part, and we're going to sing that song, See Yourself When All Is New. It's in the songbook. And Oh, sorry. In the program, sorry. Yeah, see yourself when all is new, and then we close with a prayer. Loving Father, with appreciative hearts, Father, we approach you this morning. We recognize you as the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulations. And oh, do we have tribulations, Father. That is only one of those, but there are many other tribulations that we're dealing with. But you will comfort us. You continue to do that, and you will do it right on into the future. So we ask your blessings. We pray that you will strengthen the Mc Kenzie family. We know that it's a great loss. Larry was always warm and endearing and welcoming. We're going to miss him, but we can look forward to the future. So strengthen, help us to encourage the family members to look toward the future and help them to be able to cope at this particular time. May you continue to protect us, dear Father, in these difficult times, and help us to meditate on the hope that you have shared with us through your word this morning. Forgive us for our sins, please, Father Jehovah, and may you care for us as we go through the rest of the day. We thank you for your patience with us. We thank you for your love, and we do so in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hello, good morning. Can everybody hear me? All right. This makes me uncomfortable. If you guys are uncomfortable, let me know. I'll put it back on. So I had a close encounter with COVID. I'm Sean, and I'm Larry McKenzie's oldest son that's present here. I believe in time, and I believe that time is of the essence. A lot of people here, as I look across the crowd and who's trying to make it here, I appreciate you coming. And in debt, we always feel sad, right? And we don't have a reason to smile. But I don't believe that's how it should be. I mean, you could deal with stuff the best way you believe in. The reason I'm not in black is because I don't like black at a funeral. I just think it's depressing. He has passed on. He has a new life. Like the gentleman said, that we're the ones that's left behind. We have to deal with life. Why wear colors that don't express joy, don't express happiness, don't express life? I don't know if you guys noticed the flowers here and how this place is decorated. You don't ever see a black flower, do you? So why there's always black at funerals? I believe in color, and I want to apologize right away for people who get offended by what I say. I'm not here to offend anyone, but I'm just going to be honest, and I'm going to be myself. My father was an intelligent man, and my father was, he was good at his moments. Like we all are. We're good in moments in life. We're not always great. We're not always great people. Nobody could stand here and tell me they were a great person their entire life. You'd be lying. And there'll be people say that you're lying. We take account for our lives while we're here. What we do in every moment that we use and every moment that we have here on this earth, the people that are next to you, the most important people in your life, the ones that you should share your time with, the ones that you should put your love and compassion into. When people pass on, like my father's passed on, my sister's passed on, you allow them to go in peace and you leave in peace. You mourn in your own way, however you decide to do that, whatever, however you feel. The gentleman here, I want to just be frank. I like to be honest. Because this is my time to speak. this is my family's event. That took too long. It took too long. It should have been like 15 minutes, 10 minutes out of here. I had a lot to say, and I can't. And I had a lot to write, and I wrote. And the Holy Spirit woke me up this morning at 2 a.m. I haven't slept since. And filled my head with so much to say about my father, but I cannot express that to you anymore. We're on a time schedule, and unfortunately, I'm running out of time. So I'm going to just quote something really quick, give you a couple more tidbits from my mind, and I'll let my aunt speak that's here to represent my father's side. And I'll tell you two quick things about my father that I remember that stays with me and my family. One, that he's a great-grandfather. He was a great-grandfather to my kids. He would call every birthday, every Christmas, and in between holidays, he would send stuff for his granddaughters. He said words that I never heard from my father's voice in his presence, things that make me laugh when I heard him say it, but I was happy to hear him say it, because I know he changed in a lot of things that, in a lot of ways, that he used to be, and he was different. He was different. We can all be different and take a little, to lesson from him. But he said things like, I love you, and Grandpa is so proud of you. It made me laugh because my granddaughters are hearing a great thing from their grandfather, and they were really, really broken, heartbroken. They're only 6 and 9 when he passed on. And I had to explain to them his situation, and they understood because I had a brush with COVID also, and I stood in the hospital for 2.5 weeks, and my account for life and the way I believe and everything when I left the hospital has changed. So I don't excuse myself for people anymore. I'm not gonna say I'm sorry, which I just did, and I take it back. I'm not sorry. I am honest, I'm frank. You ask me a question, I will give you a straight answer. I don't care for how you feel. If you want an answer from me, you will get exactly what's on my chest and on my mind. I'm not gonna apologize. Life is too short to be apologizing to people. Just do right by folks, do what you're supposed to do, and try and live in peace and happiness. And if I give you this quote, I might go over time. I want my aunt to be able to speak. But the essence of it is that we have this obscure view of life and time. We run by our own clock. We don't work by God's clock, which is it's a perception that we have time. But we don't know what today is gonna offer. We don't know what tomorrow is gonna offer. We don't know what we're gonna encounter after this service. I encourage you to be compassionate to one another and to your family. Listen to people. The best people that you could have around you is somebody that will be quiet and listen to you. Because people talk too much. I tend to talk too much. As I'm getting older, I talk a lot. And you are doing somebody a disservice by talking way too much and not listening to them. Whether it's your friend, it's your father, it's your mother, your sister, whoever. Take time to listen to what people have to say. It makes a whole lot of difference in their life. When you could listen, they know they could come to you and you could hear them, and they have somebody to sit down and listen to what they have to say, no matter what it is. My wife talks a lot. And it's okay to laugh at that. A funeral, you guys make it too sad. This is a sad situation, yes, but it's a joyous occasion also. Because suffering is something that nobody wants to do. And if you feel like somebody is suffering, and I believe my father was suffering, because I know what it feels like not to have breath in your lungs. And now he's laid to rest and he's not suffering anymore. With that said, I'm not gonna take much more of your time. Like I said, time is of the essence. And we don't have much left. But I want you guys to know, if you take anything from this, when you leave here, whatever you do, and whatever your day, and whatever the rest of your life looks like, take account for everything that you do and enjoy the moments in life. Don't wait for something great to happen. Make something great happen the day of, or the day of the next day that you enjoy. Don't wait for a great vacation. Enjoy life now. That may never come. You may never get that vacation. You may never get there. Don't plan stuff too far ahead. Plan in the very near future. Don't make your life based on time that you don't have. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Are you hearing me? I have my mask on. Okay, I am Anne Marie, one of Larry's sisters. I was asked to say something from his very early life, and I have to cut it short because we're on a time constraint here. Okay, so I will just share something with you very briefly on him. Larry was born in Guayco Sangre Grande to Arthur and Marjorie Mackenzie. He was the fifth of eight children. My first impression of Larry as a child was when he was given the responsibility of bringing me to and from elementary school at the tender age of five. He, at that time, was the oldest of four kids still attending Sangre Grande Government School. And all went well with this arrangement until one day I decided that I can bring myself home from school. And so I did. I came home with my friends. Now, this did not sit well with Larry at all. Larry was a young boy, just about 12 years old, thereabouts. And he had the responsibility of me. And he had to search every classroom, every toilet, okay? When he was finished with his classes, because I was much younger. And eventually when he couldn't find me, okay, he decided to come home. My mother couldn't do anything at that time because there were no cell phones to call him and tell him I was safe at home. So we waited. Eventually, Larry came home. We were living on a hill, and Larry came up. We could feel the steam from the bottom of the hill. And when he got home, he said to me, listen to me, Anne-Marie. I was given the responsibility of bringing you to and from school. You are never to leave that school without me. And that was my first impression of Larry and how serious he took his responsibility. And this is my point here today. I have to cut it short. I can't go on and on. Larry accepted responsibility. This is something I observed about him right through his life. He took the responsibility for his siblings. Thereafter, he took the responsibility of making sure his children were well. You know, they were given everything, and then that extended to his grandchildren to the day he died. Larry always felt that he was responsible for his family. He never reneged on that. Always, I could remember, to the day he died, he had that sense of responsibility, accountability, and he always embraced that to the very end. There's more I can say, but as time is of the constraint, but I wanted to impress that upon all those who are here. Larry was a man who took whatever he did seriously. Be his children, if he's dealing with his children, his nephews, his nieces, his grandchildren. And this is my impression of my brother, all through his life, from early straight up. Okay, thanks everyone. Okay.
To come up and leave your signature on this bulletin board, you can make your way to the front. Thank you.
Oh, my Savior God, to thee how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee how great thou art, how great thou art. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. Soul, my Savior God, to thee soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Accepted, there's light refreshments on the outside, so you could have consume it when you're going out. Thanks.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art, when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill, then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou
sings my soul, my Savior.